honored to be back hosting the 65th annual Tony Awards, and I'd like to deliver a very important message on behalf of all of us who care so deeply about this community. If you've seen a show, then you already know how magical theater can be. It's a two-hour live-action, barely affordable, unlip-synced version of Glee. So this song goes out to the rest of you, those who've never seen theater before. Because Broadway has never been broader. It's not just for gays anymore. If you feel like someone that this world excludes, it's no longer only for dudes who like dudes. Attention, every breeder, you're invited to the theater. It's not just for gays anymore. The glamour of Broadway is beckoning straights, the people who marry in all 50 states. We're asking every hetero to get to know us better. Oh, it's not just for gays anymore.
Hi, this is Carlos Marrero, and you are watching Trendencias, reporting on the exciting world of fashion, beauty, and entertainment. I am ready for my close-up, and tonight is the night of Broadway. Turn on the lights, because we are just going to shine so bright. We have a fabulous costume designer from Broadway, and we have a producer from Broadway tonight, and a lot of surprises. So stay tuned, because it's going to get real juicy real fast. Before I start, I just want to say thank you so much for supporting Trendencias. If you want to do us a favor and want to hit the button that says Start, Watch, Party, do that now, or share with us, share us after the show is over. But please let us, help us keep growing. And this is also a live show, so anything can happen. So get ready, because maybe a curse word or some slide doesn't happen. I don't know what's going to happen, but I'm very, very, very excited. And I'm even more excited about our guests, because we are going to be talking about everything Broadway. So this person, he graduated from the New York University costume designer. He has been working in costumes since 1977. So actually, at the tender age of 3, he started working as a costume designer on Broadway. And I am so happy to have him. His name is Jim Buff, also known as ELECTRA. Let's take a look at what he does at night.
Some queens are glad to die for love. They admire a classic beauty. But I prefer impressions like Electra's Bette or Judy. I'm Electra E, and I'm a drag, you see, because my face is painted up like a color TV. I do Judy Garland and girls like that, but as for Cher, well, I'm too damn fat. I started years ago, my padding head to toe, but I still straighten up when I bend. And though my youth is parted, I'm just getting started. Electra is both real and pretend. Now there may come a time when I could use a walker, a death drop could be my end. No dancing, no popping, no locking.
Thank you for that marvelous introduction. I put a spell on you.
But enough about you. Let's talk about me. I bet you didn't expect me to look quite. You were expecting a beefier gal. Give it up, boys and girls. Admit it. And let's go.
He has so much experience in costuming. He has a plethora of knowledge, and he's just going to share with us tonight. I am so excited to introduce you, my dear friend, Jim Buff, aka ELECTRA. Welcome to Trendencias.
Hey, how are you?
Hi. Oh my God.
No cosmetics tonight.
Oh my God.
Just a Carlos Marrero original.
Oh, Marrero collection t-shirt. Yes, I love it. Jim, welcome. I'm so excited to have you tonight. And I want you to talk to me because a lot of people know you as ELECTRA, but I knew your background in costume design. And to me, you have so much knowledge about all of these shows. You work at a place, and I'm going to let you talk about it, the place, because it's kind of like the biggest library of Broadway costumes. Talk to me a little bit about why did you decide, how was your trajectory becoming a costume designer?
Well, I studied costume design. Actually, I studied illustration and commercial art in undergraduate school at University of North Carolina at Charlotte. And I transferred over into the theater department as a costume design major. I got excited about costuming. And I started working. My Romeo and Juliet was my first play, and I was like, I learned how to sew. And the costume designer said, "You're like a duck to water with this sewing machine." So it just became a natural thing with me, and I started pursuing costume design. Then I moved to New York to get my master's degree in costume design at NYU School of the Arts, Tisch School of the Arts. Along with, I had some wonderful people as classmates in my class. Tony Kushner, who wrote Angels in America.
Wow.
And Eric LaSalle, who was on ER. He was one of the actors there. John C. McGinley, who was on Scrubs. He was one of my classmates. And the year before me was a fabulous costume designer named Greg Barnes, who's won 2 Tony Awards. Me, no Tonys, but but you know, there's always time. And then after about 15 years in New York, I decided my ELECTRA career took off, and I came down here to work at a show called An Evening at La Cage on a new place called South Beach. It was it was the Riviera of the Americas, you know, and that was back in the early 90s. And I've been here ever since. But I balance back and forth between ELECTRA and doing costume design now at the Wick Theater up in Boca Raton. And I work as the head costumer at a place called Costume World. It's in Pompano. It's located in Pompano. And it houses the largest collection of all the Broadway shows and a lot of movies also in the United States. And they do rent them out so that other people can share and enjoy the work of many years.
Do you remember your first Broadway show?
Yes, I do. It was called Ain't Misbehaving with Nell Carter.
Oh, I love Ain't Misbehaving. Yeah.
And that was in 1977. That's basically the same time I came to New York with a school group, and I saw Ain't Misbehaving. And at that time I saw Bent with Richard Gere. You know, and there was nudity in that one. That was a play. Let's see, what else did I see? Oh, Evita. I saw Evita
With Patti LuPone. At the time,
Yeah, absolutely. And Mandy Patinkin. And, it was such an event. And that's when Studio 54 was around. I got to go to Studio 54. I mean, it was a booming time.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, that was the right place to be there, right?
Sure was.
We're not going to talk about the partying tonight. We're going to talk about keeping it clean and cute, okay? So exactly. What are we drinking? Because I'm drinking my share.
I'm drinking a special Moulin Rouge concoction.
Oh, I love the Moulin Rouge. I was not able to see it.
I saw it right before it opened in what they call previews. You know, when they preview a show for several weeks, where they tweak it and they get it, fine tune it, and get it ready, and they get all the press excited about it, and you know, so they can get the word out there. And during that time, my husband and I were spending our anniversary going to see Moulin Rouge right before it opened.
And then you posted a picture and you were wearing that t-shirt of mine, and I didn't get to see the show.
I mean, I do have other t-shirts, but this is one of my favorite t-shirts.
Yeah. Thank you, baby. Thank you. You will be back in the show. So I wanted to talk a little bit about tonight. What we want to do, we want to talk about feature some of the shows that we think have the most amazing costumes. And let me entertain you. Should we start with a show?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, so there is a show that you recommended that I have not seen, and it's called Sophisticated Ladies. Do you want, of course
you're going to be the original playbill, yeah.
Yes, oh my God. I didn't see this, but I saw the, when I was editing the video, and it's amazing. Let's have our viewers take a look at Sophisticated Ladies, okay?
Okay.
His music, if it ain't possessing, beneath the blue.
Sophisticated ladies, and they are very much so.
That was my first show I ever worked on in a professional shop in New York City on Broadway. Willa Kim is the designer of that. Crazy, but a magical lady. I mean, to put two different colors together for tuxedos, you know, one
I saw the gold.
It was actually like an apricot and a silvery gold color together.
Oh, wow.
I mean, beautiful. You know, just to give the shadows and highlights, and she built, you didn't see that in any of the clips, but she built or rebuilt a taxi cab costume out of four people became this entire taxi cab costume on stage. It was really wonderful.
Wow.
And of course the gorgeous Phyllis Hyman.
Well, this is what I wanted to talk about, because I love Phyllis Hyman, the lady that when I was doing the editing, if you heard this gorgeous voice, is Phyllis Hyman. I met her a couple of times at the Baton Show Lounge in Chicago. She loved a good drag show, and she was pretty much a drag queen herself.
She was pushing 6 feet tall. She was right at it, you know, and she was a healthy sized lady, you know. So she was like one of the boys, is one of the girls.
Absolutely, yeah. You could totally couldn't tell if she was a boy or a girl.
Right, that's true.
All right. So you are wearing this beautiful t-shirt that I'm upset because you wore it to a very special show that I did not get to see. I remember when this show started, because it started in Washington, and then it moved to New York, which is called the Moulin Rouge.
Yeah. And all the shows do that. All shows start somewhere else. They test it out.
Well, this is one of those.
To Broadway.
Yeah, this is one of those movies that even last night I watched it again because I love this movie. I believe it's the same director of Strictly Ballroom who did this movie. And I loved his sense of humor and his kind of like, let's just take a look at it, shall we?
Sure.
All right, this is the Moulin Rouge.
Sister, flow, sister, go, sister, soul, sister, flow, sister. He met mama
Oh my God, I can't stop dancing.
The place was amazing, Carl.
I lost your sound. There you go.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. The whole theater was draped out. The whole audience was draped in those string patio party lights. And it was such an environmental piece to be in a Broadway house, but to be surrounded by Moulin Rouge. You felt like you were in the Moulin Rouge, complete with the elephant coming out of one of the boxes, you know, on the sides of the theater, you know, the box seats.
Yeah.
The big elephant. And then the windmill. The windmill was on the other side.
Oh,
it was totally amazing. So you were totally encompassed. They decked out the entire theater where the audience sits too, so that you felt like you were part of the Moulin Rouge. It was amazing.
Well, Mr. Buff, I have some news for you.
Yeah?
We are not alone. Because tonight we have one of the producers for the Moulin Rouge, my dear friend, Larry Rogoski. Larry, hi!
Bravo!
Welcome. You're on mute. You need to unmute yourself there. You're mute.
Can't hear.
We can't hear you.
How about now?
Yes, we can hear you. Yes.
Carlos, just so you know, I did not touch anything. Maybe I should
have. Larry, I am so happy that you're here tonight.
Thank you for having me.
You're here from New York, and this is what I love about this show, that we can have people from everywhere. It's the first time that I have three people on the show, and I'm so excited that it's this way. Larry, your show was epic, and you have produced other shows before. The first question that I have to shoot at you is, like, how did Moulin Rouge come into your hands? How did you get your hands into this amazing, mind-blowing show?
Well, thank you. Well, first of all, just seeing those clips makes me miss it so much. You know, we haven't been at the theater since March 13th. We were actually the first show on Broadway to close because we're the only ones that have a Thursday matinee. We don't have Wednesday matinees. We have Thursday matinees. And that was the day, actually, one of our cast members had a fever and was sick. And it all started to tumble from there, as you guys all know. So, you know, I got involved in Moulin Rouge. I'm one of several producers. It takes a village.
It takes a village. Like,
to produce Broadway shows. And Moulin Rouge, you ready for this, is a whopping $28 million show. So,
wow. I can see it. I can see it.
And it's that's the thing about Moulin Rouge. You see the money. Sometimes you go to a Broadway show and you're like, where'd the money go?
Where'd this go? Right.
With Moulin Rouge, you see the money. But I got involved, you know, I as soon as I heard Moulin Rouge was coming to Broadway, you know, Baz Luhrmann, who did the movie and also did Strictly Ballroom, like you said earlier, is very involved. And as soon as I heard it was going to happen, I have a producing partner. I said, we have to be part of Moulin Rouge. That's it. So we went to some workshops and we quickly got involved. And it was interesting because in the Broadway world, you know, it was a big nut. It was a big, like, risky show, even though it's such a title. But it could go either really amazingly, which it is, or really wrong.
Because the movie was so amazing, it's like people compare. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so people were afraid. Some people were afraid even to get involved, but we weren't. We dove right in. I'm so glad we did. And the show actually was out of town in Boston.
It was Boston. Okay.
Yeah. And it was at the Colonial Theater, which was newly renovated, and we were the first show in it.
I wanted to go back then. I didn't even know that you were producing it back then. Stop showing off, Mr. Jim.
I just want to show Larry.
Yes.
The Moulin Rouge Cup.
You support it.
I don't have a Carlos Marrero original shirt, or otherwise I would have worn that too. I love this one. I mean, it's Moulin Rouge shirt. It's great.
Coming soon to a theater near you. All right, Larry, can you give us, I'm going to show a couple of slides right here. The costumes are just outstanding. Can you tell us a little bit about anything that you want to give us, some behind the scenes tea about the costume?
Ooh, I mean, without giving away too much, you know, I just think first
give
all,
away everything, all
right.
Girl.
You can see right there. I mean, the costumes are just sumptuous. Is I think the
Catherine
best word
Zibbers. To excellent. Use.
Yeah, yeah. So she's our Catherine Zuber is our amazing costume designer. And you could see in the picture on the left, the
girls.
Lady Marmalade girls. Yeah. And the one all the way on the right is actually not a girl.
She's not?
Amazing actor.
Oh, you're kidding me. I didn't know.
You would know it. And that's what's so beautiful about the show. It's totally gender fluid. And I think, you know, Catherine had so much fun playing around with the costumes with it. You got to remember, these costumes are so lavish and so amazing and very expensive because they have to go 8 times a week. They have to last through and hopefully years and years and different actors fitting into them. I mean, they go through a lot.
Well, also the design of them is so clever because the music is so contemporary and the look is turn of the century. She was very clever in the use of fabrics and the way she styled things to make them look as desired as in modern day as they would be back in the 1800s.
Yeah.
I think it's amazing.
One of the things that I love is obviously the music. And you took the movie music and, well, not you because it was done before you came around, but like they added a bunch of other songs, like Burning Down the House and all of these other songs that I was just like, I would die.
Rolling
I literally would die.
Oh, here's the thing about Moulin Rouge. If you just tried to put the movie on stage, it would have failed miserably. You cannot just put the movie on stage. And I think the opportunity here also, there's 71 songs in the show.
Mm-hmm.
So what an opportunity to get to update it and put in some, I call them the new classics, like Rolling in the Deep and Firework, Katy Perry's Firework, all these great songs. And there were, honestly, there were a couple songs that were in it in Boston and also in the workshops that got cut for various reasons.
Oh, and Shirley Bassey's Diamonds Are Forever. Before Sparkling Diamonds sings Diamonds Are Girl's Best Friend. It's absolutely breathtaking.
It's probably one of my favorite moments in the show is when Satine descends from the rafters, like she does in the film. But when you see it live in a theater, it's breathtaking.
Diamonds Are Forever, Shirley Bassey.
I would get. And I'm sure that when this little number came, like the whole house probably got on their feet and they just like
the audience goes wild.
It's Lady Marmalade. I mean,
it's like these big Valentines though. I mean that heart just it telescopes out and it irises in. There's layers of that heart and it goes back and forth. It's amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, Larry, I have a question for you. Which one is your favorite song of the whole show? Is this like picking one of picking your kid out of like your favorite kid if you have 6 of them?
So there's so many songs, but my favorite series of songs is the opener of Act 2.
Okay.
Which is Lady Gaga's Bad Romance.
Uh-huh.
And how it starts, it's so free and sexy and the dancing
tango.
Is
oh my god.
Unlike anything else you see on Broadway. Yeah. Sonia Tai is the choreographer, she's from So You Think You Can Dance. It's the first Broadway show she choreographed.
I didn't know that.
It's her first one. And she's actually choreographing another Broadway show. We're on intermission right now. There's no shows happening right now. but, you know, she did just such amazing things with these dancers. But she really workshopped it with these dancers and on their bodies. So it is extremely physical, extremely athletic. I mean, they're an amazing
show. I don't know how those kids do it eight times a week. It's incredible because it just looks exhausting. I'm like those poor clothes. They're not going to last. I mean, it's just amazing what they go through and sometimes they go through it twice a day. You know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Another question that I wanted to ask you is, what is that feeling when it first goes live? Like, even if it's like on previews, the first time that people are walking in the theater. Curtain goes up, you're a producer. I think, I can't even imagine.
Well, a big tradition on Broadway is before previews start, there's usually a final dress, an invited final dress. And you just hope that, you know, things go well that night. And that night for Moulin Rouge, so first of all, it's all producers and friends and people in the theater. And it's just, it erupted. It was so exciting. And, you know, there were several standing ovations throughout the show. And that actually keeps happening even as we're running.
There were the night I was there. Several.
And, you know, with the show, the audience, I mean, hopefully you're not next to one of these people that's like singing along the whole time. You're usually drunk and singing along the whole time.
But you know what? You can't help but sing along.
You can't.
Not unlike the movie, you know, the songs are familiar, but they're even more familiar now, and they're familiar to a bigger demographic of people because
there's older songs. Yeah, older and new songs. You had Lady Gaga, you had Shirley Bassey.
Which is like the basis for the whole design, too. It's like old and new together. It's amazing. It's really amazing.
It's many generations. A question that I have and that I received when I announced that you were going to be in the show is, how affected is Broadway? And do you have any idea on when are you coming back? If you're coming back, I know you are, but anywhere of any idea, are you coming back in a different country before you come back on this in this country? Give me some feedback of where is Broadway and your take, because we live for Broadway. I know Jim probably feels the same.
Sure. That's the question of the year here, right? So, you know, when we first shut down, it was going to be a month. And we were like, oh my God, month. Okay. But then we thought, okay, a month, we can do this. And now it's turned into, what is it? It's been since March 12th. So what is that, 6 months, whatever it is now. And we're scheduled now to be closed through January 3rd. Most likely we are not going to open January 4th. I'm being full disclosure here. I can't give you an exact date because nobody knows. It depends on a lot of factors. You have to think about it. Broadway theaters are typically, you know, anywhere from 500 to 2,000 seats. Moulin Rouge theater is around 1,400 seats. So think about being in that small space, waiting in line for the bathroom, getting your cocktail, sitting right next to someone for 2.5 hours. Like, nobody wants to do that right now. So this has been devastating for our industry. For anything in the live entertainment, it's just devastating.
Yeah.
And not, you know, most people think about the actors, which of course you should, and it's been, for them, it's been tough. They've that artistic outlet, but they're getting very creative and finding ways to do stuff with Zoom and film and TV and all sorts of other ways, at drive-in movie theaters, standing on the back of pickups, singing.
Mm-hmm.
But I think of all the peripheral, you know, first of all, everybody backstage, and then just think about the company managers, the stage managers, the restaurants, the pedicab guy. I mean, everything is affected. Yeah.
But also not just on Broadway. I mean, at our theater here at the Wick. I mean,
everywhere.
The regional theaters, it's the same way. And the Actors Union, Equity Rules, they have to come to terms with what they can do. Just think about a dressing room. You know, not everybody has a private dressing room. So you're sharing a dressing room right next to someone else. You know, in the play, you're dancing and you're touching the other person.
Right.
You know, there may be a kiss. In Moulin Rouge, there's a lot of kissing. You know,
yeah, I mean, a lot of sweat and a lot of kissing.
A lot of spit.
A lot of
all of that's going on. Then you have test, like walking patterns backstage, you know, between scenery and everything else. And it's a lot to deal with.
The so people that change you, the people that change your costumes, they're right next to you, they're touching you. Anyway,
I'm still doing fittings on things, not for theater, but fittings on particular costumes. And I have to wear rubber gloves and a mask and everything else because I'm this close. I'm pinning the pins in the person, you know. So so it's a lot to deal with. Yeah.
So, Larry, for our viewers that we have on tonight and on the repeat of the show, how can we help?
Oh, that's a great question. So first of all, when theater reopens, wherever that is, not just Broadway, and you feel safe, you should go to the theater.
Absolutely.
But not until you feel safe. It's irresponsible for any producer to say, you know, as soon as we open, come back. But, you know, I really think until there's the vaccine, until there's some precautions that can be taken, you know, we're learning a lot. There's a production of the Phantom of the Opera that's happening in Seoul, Korea right now that's going, and we're learning a lot from what they're doing. There's check this out, there's two productions that just opened Great Barrington. Why can't I think of what it's called right now? Anyway, up north. And one of God's
in the United States.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay. Godspell is one, and Harry Clark. Where's my brain right now? Anyway, the production of Godspell, which was just reviewed yesterday in the New York Times, they gave it a great review, and it's so interesting. They're all in masks. They have walk patterns. There's 10 people in the cast. There's 75 people in the audience, and they're behind like shielded glass. It's very much. And God, with Godspell, you can do stuff like that, right?
Sure.
So it's really interesting how there's the workaround for it. Mm-hmm. But how else, you know, you can give to my favorite place to give is Broadway Cares, Equity Fights AIDS. The reason why, oh, there it is. So these red buckets are amazing. And you'll see these red buckets when you actually go to a show. You've ever been to a show and at the end, the cast member will step out and say, you know, we're raising money for Broadway Cares right now. And you know, you throw $1, $2, $100, whatever in the bucket. And they raffle things off. That's Broadway Cares, Equity Fights AIDS. And they do so much to help people. You know, if there's a hurricane, Broadway Cares comes through. If there's an earthquake, Broadway Cares comes through. Right now with COVID, Broadway Cares is coming through in a big, big, big way. So if you have anything you could spare, Broadway Cares is a great place to give it because you know it's going to go where it's needed. So certainly to the Broadway community and beyond.
Dear viewers, if you love Broadway and you have to know that these people are going through a lot, because people think of all of these other people suffering, but like Broadway, you have the ticket people, you have the people that sit you, you have all of these people that need some help. So BroadwayCares.org, BroadwayCare.org is the place to go. So thank you, Larry. And we're going to let's change the topic from sad and I don't want to say depressing, but
it's the Berkshires. Sorry, that's
the Berkshires. Oh,
Dorinda from the Housewives of New York.
That's where Godspell is happening.
Stockbridge, Massachusetts.
Yeah,
up there in the Berkshires.
Oh, yes. Awesome.
Under tents.
But the good thing is, like, now you get to learn what they're doing. I hate to be that person, but you get to learn what they're doing, and then you can tweak it to make it happen for you because it's all I don't know what I'm saying, but I feel like if they're doing something, you can see it and then you can tweak it into.
Learn from it. Lots of shows start at places like that, out of town, you know, the Williamstown Theater Festival. There's so many theater festivals everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
You know, things are, I've worked on many shows that, you know, like, I mean, shows right now that I have on Broadway. So Moulin Rouge, Jagged Little Pill is another show that is currently playing on Broadway. I'm a producer on. We were at ART. In Cambridge, Massachusetts, before coming into Broadway. The show Company, I'm a producer on. Also, we were open in London last year. Now it's coming to Broadway. So,
All right. So let's hope for a better day. And if we want to pump it with a trumpet because it's time for the fashion memes of the week. And this is where we can have a little kiki about, like, oh no, I don't know, just some fun. And let me just take this out. And the fashion memes of the week, let's start with, what do we have when we mix cats with West Side Story? The ultimate Broadway musical mash, Cat Side Story. and I believe that Jim didn't
now,
work
on
Cats.
All sharks or jets?
Jim, didn't you work in Cats as well?
I did work. I worked for John Napier, who was the designer on the original Cats. I latch hooked silk rags through leg warmers for days and weeks at a time. But I had a crush on the designer, John Napier.
Oh, I thought you had a crush on one of the cats.
No.
Because I'm a cat lady.
I'm a dog person.
I'm a cat person.
But so, I did work on the original. Yeah.
But were you able to defy gravity?
No, I was never able to. Even though I've been called a witch from time to time, I've never been able to defy gravity.
Our next meme is like, one does not simply defy gravity. And then, of course, the witch is, ha-ha. Yes. We love Wicked.
Adina Menzel.
Like no other.
I saw Wicked the day after she won the Tony, and her and Christian Chenoweth are on the bed singing Popular, and Christian Chenoweth holds up her mirror and she goes, this looks like a Tony, but I wouldn't know. The play stopped. It stopped. The orchestra stopped. I told my husband, I said, do you realize this will never happen again? This is like a moment.
Are you Adina kidding?
Adina got off the bed. She took a bow, standing ovation. They got back on the bed and started the number all over again.
Oh, that was my God.
That little Christian Chenoweth, you know, like this looks like a Tony, but I wouldn't know. You know, because they were both up for the Tony and she won. Yeah.
Oh my God. Amazing. I love her. Amazing. I love her. Yeah. So I don't know how you guys feel about how 2020 is going, but my plans for 2020 were a little bit like Beauty and the Beast. And actually, this is what we got. Oh,
is that you, Carlos, in that picture?
That's me as the Beast. No, that's me as the Beast.
That's more like Booty and the Beast.
Exactly. All right, so let's go to another show, shall we?
Sure. Let's do it.
Okay, so let's look at another show. And this other show was actually the first show that I saw on Broadway. And it is none other than the longest running show. Larry, correct me if I'm wrong. The Phantom of the Opera.
You are correct, sir.
Okay, let's take a look at some clips of The Phantom of the Opera.
Turn your face away from the garish light of day. Turn your thoughts away from cold, unfeeling light. And listen to the music of the night.
Masquerade.
I've got an idea. I mean, Phantom could come back if he just took the mask and switched it around to here to cover up here. You know, he'd have to be afflicted this way, you know. But you know,
Jim, always an entrepreneur. We gotta get our coins somewhere.
I gotta tell you, I never saw Phantom until about 2 years ago. I finally went to see it. How long was it playing? 30 years at that point?
Yeah, sure.
A friend of mine is the understudy for The Phantom, and he was going on. So I'm like, I'm going to go see it. So finally I did. He was brilliant, by the way. His name is Jeremy Stoll. But I looked around the audience, and I was like, that's why this show is running for years. There was not one single person around me, except for the Brits, who spoke English.
Sure.
So because it's such a universal, and it's like you don't have to understand the language.
No.
And that's why it works, which will be interesting when we come back and, you know, for shows like that, if they will be able to survive because they really rely on tourists. And we don't know when tourism is coming back.
Yeah.
So it's like, I think that the shows that probably will do the strongest, at least at first, are the ones that really appeal to New Yorkers.
Larry, and I don't want to interrupt.
Go ahead.
I don't want to interrupt you, Larry, but.
With rings.
With rings?
No. Have you seen those masks for singers? Those ones that come way out like this?
Oh, yeah.
It's like a duck-bill platypus or something. It's like this weird thing. I haven't seen it. It's scary. Go ahead.
I just wanted to say that, Larry, I have no doubt that Moulin Rouge, with the type of music and the type of costumes it will be back. And I'm going to put you on the spot.
Years.
And I will pay for my tickets, but you better give me good seats. Honey,
Do you know what? There's not a bad seat.
You know me.
There's not a bad seat in that whole place.
Uh-oh.
There, oh, no.
I want a bad seat.
I don't care about there's no bad seat in the. No, no, no.
I want in your lap.
I want Rogowski treatment. Oh,
right. Right by the passerelle. You know, it's right by the passerelle there.
So, Jim, I have a question for you. What can you tell us about the costumes of the Phantom of the Opera?
Well, for one thing, we were discussing this before, that during Masquerade, half of those people are just mannequins. But now these costumes would be turn of the century French in design. All of the intricate work, even the petticoats in this show, were hand embroidered originally. Now I'm sure later on that they found some other solution to them, but all the costumes from this show were lots of silk, lots of sumptuous fabrics that were actually hand embroidered, and for a show to last that long,
intricate work, even the petticoats,
it's incredible. Well, now I'm going. Now I hear myself. I think
it's all right. Yeah, I can hear you. I can hear you perfectly. One of the things that I love. I'm going to put it back. But on the right, Carlota comes out of the wings, and she took almost the whole stage by herself. You can't see it here because this is from an opera picture. The train took almost the whole stage by herself because. Divas back then in the opera, they took like the whole stage with their skirt, and that's why
the
I love
character. The character of Carlotta is so she's so over the top, you know. You almost know she's going to deserve to be clocked by a chandelier, you know. she's asking for it, you know. She's just asking for it to happen. But when I designed a version of Phantom, and Carlotta is always my favorite character. It was a bustle period, and the bustle went on. It had like a caboose on the end of the bustle. It was so big. It's a wonderful show to design, though.
And by the way, I have to tell my viewers that Carlotta is not related to me. I am Carlos. I am not Carlotta. Oh,
in certain circles.
Larry, so thank you for your input on the Phantom of the Opera, but I just love it. And I feel like it's and correct me if I'm wrong, but for theater buffs or for theater nerds, probably Phantom is like is this like Burger King? I'm putting you on the spot because yes. I've been drinking my Chardonnay share juice.
The answer is yes.
It's presentational.
It is. It's not one of my favorites. You go see it first. It's so classic. Absolutely. And some of the music, it's beautiful. But also, Broadway has changed. And I love the Broadway of right now. I think what's happening right now on Broadway, there is some amazing. I mean, with this Hamilton, I mean, you guys have probably seen.
Wow.
You know, yeah. Disney. It's like these kind of Dear Evan Hansen, these really groundbreaking new ways of storytelling. Mm-hmm. It floors me, and I think it's really ushered in this new style, which is great, and it's very different. And the Phantom was a definitive style. And when it came out in the 80s, it was groundbreaking. Now, to me, it feels a little creaky, but there's still a place for it. Don't get me wrong. It's still
the thing about it is, when revivals come around, it makes you want to see them again. Because you've got all these new groundbreaking type musicals and Broadway shows, then when an oldie comes around, when a Gypsy comes around, or a Mame, or whatever, it comes around. Whether it's a fresh approach or not, it's welcomed in as a part of history, and that's the good thing about Broadway.
I do want to say something because I'm an artist and I always save my coins when I go to New York because people say, I'm going to New York for shopping. I'm going to New York for that. I'm going to New York for Broadway. Oh,
say that again.
I'm going to New York for Broadway. And when I go to New York, I buy, Larry, don't hate me, but I buy one regular price ticket for the main event.
Yeah.
Last time it was for Bette Midler's
Hello, Dolly.
Hello, Dolly. And then what happens is that then I buy tickets for, at that point was Miss Saigon revival and then another revival. So that's what I'm saying. So
I'm not mad about that. Listen.
No.
Well, what I was going to say is like people might come for Phantom, but they end up going to two or another and another because they just, they're already there because, you know, you have to pay for hotel, you have to So if you're a Broadway baby like me, so you just make a trip out of it.
And actually the TKTS down by Wall Street, that TKTS, you get
that's the smaller one. Yeah,
because there's no line, there's hardly any lines there, and that's the way to do it. Okay,
that's
there's so many ways to get discounted tickets now, which is really incredible. Well, I'll tell you what is going to happen most likely when Broadway comes back. Ticket prices are going to be much lower.
Oh wow,
what you've what you're used to. So we want to lure people back to come see shows. So it's going to be a great time for anybody who's a real theater buff, especially, I know you guys aren't local, but for people who are local, like New Yorkers, it's we just want to get them in, you know what I mean? So it's going to be a boom time for New Yorkers to see theater.
Yeah, especially since the tourist thing may be on shaky ground to begin with, you know, you know, like at the start of the reopening of everything, there won't be as many tourists, so you really need the locals to... to support. Yeah.
Listen, all of this money talk and supporting the theater reminded me that I need to take a 30-second break for our sponsors, okay? So we're going to take a look at our sponsors and we will be right back. Stay tuned because we have a lot more. So, so how is your mask game?
Those are so Broadway, those masks.
You should
Larry,
do a Broadway mask, Carlos.
Yeah.
Well, the thing is, I don't want to get sued. I don't want to go there. I don't want to go there.
could, like a general showbiz mask, general Broadway mask, not with any show specifically. Yeah.
Like tragedy comedy, you know, whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, like the two masks in one.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Let's move to our next show, shall we?
Sure.
One of the I saw Phantom of the Opera, but one of the other shows that I saw was 42nd Street. And I know, Larry, don't raise your eyebrow or eyebrows, because this this is also one of those Phantom of the Opera big productions. Look at that original playbill.
Yeah.
I kind of died because I haven't seen this many people on stage this many, the tap dancing was great. So let's take a look real quick at 42nd. Yeah, let's take a look at 42nd Street.
Yeah.
about that little number?
The classic. Classic, yeah. You know, it is. It's like what we were talking about. It's one of those classics that's if it's not on Broadway in regional areas, it's playing somewhere.
So, Jim, let me ask you a more technical question. Is this one of the Broadway shows that has the most costumes? Because I was like, how many people are on stage right now? And not like the Phantom where there are some mannequins.
There's about 30. There's about 32 in that show, I believe. In that show with all the dames and everything. And there's so many different costume changes in that show. Costume changes for each number. The lullaby.
I love these ladies here. When I saw it, I just love. Yeah. I love this era. Period. End of story. Yeah.
We have those clothes. Those are our clothes. I mean, we own them now.
And then the tapping people.
The we're in the money. That's the we're in the money number.
Most people don't see this, but they're actually dancing on a coin.
We have those coins too. We now own those. The coin, the tap.
Come and meet those dancing feet on the avenue I'm taking you to, 42nd Street. Here's the We're in the Money costumes from 42nd Street. We even have the dancing blocks that they tap dance on for We're in the Money. Now, all the way over here, here's the lead character's costumes, Dorothy Brock's outfits, all the way down. I'm just going to give you a brief. Here's Peggy Sawyer's outfits. Peggy Lawler. Let's see. Look at the coat. How fabulous. Down to the little beaded dresses. And then all the men right here.
It's like, yeah.
All the men right there. Yeah. That's what you call me on hello.
250 costumes easily in that show.
Wow. That is just.
Any large Broadway show. I mean, Moulin Rouge has quite an array of costumes. I mean, I tried to count. I was trying to see the show, but trying to count at the same time. Being a costume, I would count about 170 something like that costumes.
Well, you know what's amazing? I don't know how many costumes are in a specific number. I should know the number, right? But if you go backstage at that show, you know, especially these older Broadway theaters, it's at the Al Hirschfeld Theater, mm-hmm. the Martin Beck Theater. The backstage area, like everything is flown up. Right. And it's like a Russian doll.
Like a library.
It's like, crazy. Things just fold into each other.
Right.
It's crazy what happens backstage. Yeah.
Because the old Broadway theaters, they don't have so much width or depth, they have height. They just have height. And so that's why they do. They take things off stage and they fly them up. Yeah.
So let's look at another play that I love so much, and we all love this. It's called Acacia Falls because it's one of those that it has, of course you have to show
the original.
Original Acacia Falls.
This is another show that opened in Boston first. The tryouts were in Boston because this is another one that I worked on. This is I worked as
look in there for Drew Geraci. His pictures. I don't know if there were pictures in there.
No, there's not pictures, but his name is here. I'll show you.
All right. So don't give it away because we're gonna talk about this after we see.
It's so wild that we.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have arrived at Acacia Falls.
Thank you. like the illusion. We love how it feels, putting on heels, causing confusion. We face life though it's sometimes sweet and sometimes bitter. Face life with a little guns and lots of glitter. Under our frocks, girdles and chocks, proving we are what we
I mean, come on. This is not the slide that I want to have right now, but this is
that's
just
Anita Moss.
Amazing. La Casa Post, we're coming
right
down.
Here.
This is
his
next.
His name's right up here.
Okay, so what's his name?
Drew Geraci.
Drew Geraci.
So this is your husband, right?
Yes.
It's not the picture that I showed, right?
I don't think so. Okay, he was the understudy for Jean Michel, the photographer, Tabaro, Chantal, Hannah from Hamburg, who I dated, the original Hannah. Mercedes.
Wait a second, isn't that Sam Singhouse?
All right, guys, let's focus.
Yeah, Sam Singhouse.
Sorry.
Back to La Casa. I know. All right,
he's
so you're telling me that your husband was in La Cage?
For 4 years, the entire run at the Palace Theater, yeah.
Oh, my God.
I didn't know him then.
You didn't know him then. And then did you know him? So we're gonna move from La Cage. Okay, let's talk a little bit about more.
Just like a quick, funny story.
Yeah, you can talk over the slides. Yeah.
About Drew. So the first Broadway show I ever saw was A Chorus Line. And Drew was playing Paul. He was the final Paul in the last 2 years of Chorus Line on Broadway. And I went to go see it when I was a senior in high school, not knowing that that was going to be my future husband. A bunch of cool, huh?
Right. That's great.
Yeah.
So what about La Casa Falls? Did he enjoy it? Is this one of his first ones? Anything you can tell us?
It wasn't one of his first, but yeah, he totally enjoyed it. They had an amazing time there. He could tell you great stories about it. I mean, it was really... You know, this was a Broadway heyday. It was also the beginning of the AIDS crisis in New York. So the whole theater industry was sort of under attack.
They redid the Palace Theater for that for La Cage.
Yeah,
because it was under construction for years.
And it is again.
Yeah, yeah.
Right now,
the costume designer Theoni Aldridge, who was infamous for. Almost every, she was Miss Broadway. I mean, for years, she designed a lot of shows on Broadway. She came to one of my drag shows to do research on my hip padding and breast padding. And it wasn't because I was a costume designer that I got to work with her. It was because I was a drag queen. She did a research at a drag bar in Brooklyn Heights. She came with Marty, with her assistant, Marty Pakladinas, who was a friend of mine. He said, you've got to go see this guy. This is how you pad the hips and this is how you do the thing. Yeah. And so I got to work on the show because of that.
So great. We got to move on because we have a couple of things to cover, but let's go back to iconic costumes, and the next one that I have is the Angel on Angels of in America, yes. Which is a show that I died over. That's the wrong word to use. I lived for it. Sorry,
right,
sorry.
Exactly.
But it was just an amazing, very timely story. And Larry, you have something to say about this particular costume?
Well, so this is the revival of Angels in America. I was the producer on this one. And those angel wings, this is one of my very favorite all-time costumes. What you don't really see here, you sort of see it. Those angel wings are being manipulated by these actors dressed in black, and they sort of get attached to the angel, that actress playing the angel. And it's all done through choreography. And the way it happens, it, like, it's really like theater magic. It's hard to even describe. It's just like, all of a sudden, she's got these wings.
You know? It's almost like Mama's Chance. Remember Mama's Chance? The way it used to happen, everything was organic like that. It was beautiful. It's
so beautiful. And not what you think of as a beautiful angel. She's like this tattered, she almost looks like pigeon wings. And that's what the concept for this.
She's like a busted angel.
She's a, which makes sense for the show.
Yeah. But you have something that you've been hiding from us for Angels in America. Can you show off a little bit here? Because nobody knows this and I didn't play this. What do you have for us?
Nobody's ever asked me to do this before or anything, but Angels in America, not only because the show near and dear to my heart, because I saw the original when I was in college and I had to be a part of this one, but I won my first Tony Award.
Award winner.
Spin it.
Pretty exciting.
Yay.
You know, being in a Radio City Music Hall, running up on stage, and it was such an evening. And for winning it for that play, for me, was like a full circle moment, you know?
And then it's a small world here because I graduated with Tony Kushner, who wrote Angels in America.
Yeah.
I went to school with him at NYU. Cool. We did. Yeah, he was a directing major there at school, and he was writing. We spoke about this before, but he was writing all that time. He's been writing that story. I mean, it's just amazing.
Yeah.
All right. So incredible. Let's go into our last show, which is one of. Let's talk about an iconic look, shall we? Let's talk about Hello Dolly, shall we? Okay.
Oh,
so
sure.
Hello Dolly has this iconic, you know, this costume. And this is the first time that I was able to see Hello Dolly. And I mean, not only Hello Dolly, but Bette Midler, who was one of my favorite ever.
She was incredible.
She was incredible.
She was totally Bette Midler and Belle Barth and all the rest of them within that character. But she was Dolly Levi.
What people don't know is that I was actually friends with a makeup artist, and Bette Midler has six of my scarves, of the Marrero collection scarves.
Oh, fabulous.
And I'm just waiting for her to wear one of those. But until then, I just love this iconic
look. Well, I impersonate her about every other way.
Whoa!
I don't know what you're talking about.
What happened?
And her wigs were attached to the hats, too.
Oh, my God. This is amazing. Okay, you're my neighbor, and I need to borrow that like right now.
I wish I lived closer now.
Just come on over,
Larry. You could be a blonde.
Save it. It attaches.
I gotta tell you,
the back of it's beautiful too.
Gorgeous.
Look at that. Craftsmanship. When Dame Edna had a show on Broadway, remember Dame Edna had the show?
Oh, yeah,
Gary, whatever his name is, Barry Evans. I don't know. Anyway, Barry Humphreys. So I was, his dresser was my roommate at the time, and she sometimes had to bring his gowns home, and I put one of them on with his glasses.
No!
He has no idea. I hope he's not watching right now. That's a picture
I love it.
Somewhere.
So if I ever go over
and visit anytime you want to.
Oh, how beautiful.
Okay, so we're going to come down for a landing, and our last show is none other than the most creative, I feel, one of the most creative, is called The Lion King. And let's take a look real quick at The Lion King.
Go!
All right, Jim.
Well,
wait. Let me say one thing, because I know you know it all, but not that you know it all, but I want to say what I know. And what I know is that Julie Taymor won the Tony Award for the first time as a woman, like the first woman who won a Tony Award for costume.
She's the first woman to win? No.
In 1998, Julie Taymor won a Tony Award for her. Oh, sorry, the direction.
Direction. I was going to say.
Sorry. Of course I messed it up, Larry.
Which is totally insane, if you ask me.
Because I would have said, well, there was Theoni Aldridge. There was
of course. Of course you have to clock me.
The director. Yeah. You would have died if I had come out with a whole big raffia mess or whatever.
I thought you were going to. I know what happened. Well, letting us down.
It's the corona. I can't. They're all quarantined in my dressing room. No, that again.
Direction.
Like the angels in America, like those wings. A lot of those costumes are manipulated puppets. You know, there's so much puppetry involved and so much of their own body articulation. What was incredible was the use of their head for one part of it, their shoulders for one part with another person involved, just to create, the dexterity of an animal. You know, I mean, it was just amazing. Those costumes were amazing. And didn't you work on that show, sir?
I did. Yeah, I was actually, for a time, I was a Broadway dresser, and that was one of the shows I was a dresser at. So I have a lot of experience with those costumes. They're very heavy.
Very heavy. Lots of straps, lots of buckling and harnessing. Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Straps? Keep talking.
Dress.
Straps.
I'm kidding.
Lots of slings and arrows.
No. We got to keep it clean. And I have to come down for a landing because it's past the hour. And I just want to thank you guys because I had the best kiki on my three-way on Trendencias with Carlos Marrero on Broadway.
Trendencias.
Yes.
Trendencias.
I want to put you on the spot, and I want us to do the top divas of Broadway and some of the other shows that we didn't have, some of the other iconic looks that we didn't have. We have Patti LuPone, we have Glenn Close, we have, I cannot even start.
Foster.
Who?
Sutton Foster. I love her.
She's absolutely, absolutely.
She's a buddy. That's why I like her.
We have to do this again. Promise?
No. Yes. Yes. And it was a pleasure meeting you, Larry.
So nice to meet you too. What a gift. What a fun evening. Fun. And Carlos, it's always great to hang with you. way too long.
Yes, way too long. And we're gonna do it again.
Neighbor, come over and you can wear a mask and a headpiece all at the same time.
She will come down and try it all on.
Sure.
Okay. So, until then, my name is Carlos Marrero. His name is Jim Buff. His name is Larry Rogowski, and you are watching Trendencias.